morning. I'm going to tell you about how to find out what that process is doing. So just a little background about me. My day job is at a company called Solano Labs. We're a hosted continuous integration service. That means we'll run your tests for you. And tests are real good, and I'm happy working on tests. Tests are one good way to find bugs in your code, to prevent bugs in your code, to understand what your code is doing so you can find the other bugs. When it's your code, you have tests. You have a bunch of other tools, too. You can make sure to have good logging so that you know all the stuff the program's doing. You can make sure to always run with the debug symbols so that if you do have to break out a debugger, it will help you well. You can even, if you're if you put a little elbow grease into it, you can have, say, a thread listening on a port or a socket, ready to, if you connect to it, give you a REPL in Python or Lisp or Ruby, whatever your language is. Just be careful about security, of course, when you do that. But that's really valuable when you have it. So all those are great when it's your code, when you're able to do them. So for everything else, you need other techniques. And that's what this talk is about. So just a little word on the format. There's too many great tools for this purpose to be able to cover them all in detail in 45 minutes, let alone really get your hands on them. This isn't the format, anyway, for you to get your hands on these. So you're not going to be experts in these after this talk. But what I hope is that the result is that in the future you have some problem, some process you want to understand, something you want to find out about it, you'll have seen what's possible. And as a result, you'll be able to think, oh yeah, there was that tool in that talk at Open Source Bridge. That would solve this problem. And then you can go maybe track down these slides, they'll be posted. If you remember the name, you can go look it up, you can play around with it, you can find how to do the thing you want to do. So that's the goal. We could maybe get hands-on in the unconference on Friday if people are interested, but I'll leave that for the future. So I'll divide the types of tools here, types of approaches, into looking from the outside and from the inside. So by the outside, I mean watching from where the program meets the operating system. And this is a great way to look at a process for two reasons. One is that it's the only way the process can talk to the outside world. This is actually kind of a fundamental aspect of what an operating system is, that it controls access to the hardware and really to everything outside of this abstract box that it's put the program into. And of course, the program is only useful to the extent it ultimately talks to the outside world. No matter what excellent computation does inside, it has to eventually tell somebody the result, or it didn't matter that you wrote it, that you ran it. So a lot of interesting stuff is visible right at the boundary with the operating system. The other reason that this is a great way to look at a process is that the interface is pretty much universal. For any given operating system, the process has to talk to the operating system in a way the system understands. And so no matter what language is written in, no matter what kind of design the authors chose, or what kind of way they structured, or what names they called things internally, when it talks to the system, it has to speak the way the system understands. And so that means that a single set of tools will interpret the speaking to the operating system for every kind of process on a given system. And even across systems, for any given system, there will be a tool that understands how it's talking. And then once that tool tells you, oh, it's opening this file, it's reading from that file, those concepts are pretty transferable across systems. So there's really, to a very high degree on one operating system, and even to a substantial degree across operating systems, there's a single skill set to learn here and a single way of approaching things. So that also makes this approach really valuable. There's a bunch of tools from the outside. I will talk about a few of the greatest ones. So one great one is the proc file system. So this is on Linux, I believe. The BSDs have a version of this too now. This will be a Linux-centric talk, basically, from here on. But a lot of this does transfer to other systems. The proc file system is where the kernel exposes to you, the sysadmin, or you, the user, exposes just about everything it knows about each of the processes that are running. It exposes a ton of information about the system. And it's a directory tree. It consists of a bunch of sort of files. They are totally files in the abstract sense, but they're not real files on disk. Rather, they're something much better. They are things that if you go and open them, or you read from them, it connects directly to routines in the kernel that exists just for the purpose of answering that query. They go and read the relevant internal data structures of the kernel and print it out in a nice format for you. So that's what makes the proc system really, really useful. And there's a lot of stuff there. So we'll get into that shortly. Another excellent tool, this might be my favorite tool, is called Strace, or strace. Strace is sort of a dual to proc. And the proc tells you everything the kernel knows about the process right now, about its status right now. Strace will let you watch it over time. You let the process run. It's not too high overhead. It doesn't slow it down too much. It does a little. Watch it over time and see all the interactions it has with the system. And as we said, that covers a wide swath of what the process does in most cases. And ultimately, it has to cover everything to some degree if it's useful. So Strace is really useful. We'll get into that as well. Another one I'll mention, but there isn't time to get into in detail in this talk, is T-Shark. It's sort of a parallel to Strace in that both of them are tools for observing stuff the process is doing. T-Shark specializes in observing communications over the network. It's a relative of Wireshark, which is a GUI version. TCP dump is another useful tool. All of these are for observing the packets that go over. And both Strace and T-Shark and his friends specialize in not only collecting, but then actually having a lot of internal intelligence to be able to interpret standard things that happen. So Strace will interpret system calls. It knows a lot about what system calls look like on your system. And T-Shark and Markshark and so on will interpret packets. They know, oh, that's a DNS query with such and such arguments. And then the result is a DNS reply, and it looks like it has this answer and so on. So it's an excellent tool, too. I won't be able to cover it in this talk. It doesn't exactly specialize in one process. It's more of watching the whole system, and you can filter it in other ways. But you should know it exists. You should look it up if you need it. So let's get into actually using a tool. So the first tool we'll talk about is procpid, or the proc file system. And by procpid, I mean /proc/some PID. So here's just a simple list. Some PID, it's the PID of my shell. LS, that directory, and there's a bunch of stuff in there. This is just a small slice of what's there. These are some of the most interesting. We'll get into some of these in detail. Others that don't need much explanation, it has the current directory. It has the actual executable that's running. It has the command line for the process, which can sometimes be a very useful thing to know. It has the environment, which is also sometimes helpful. Status is a catch-all for all kinds of things. It's worth browsing that. And procpid mem, I've never used directly, but it's the actual memory of the process. So you can imagine that gives you a lot of power. So something they didn't mention, that's because we're going to go into detail momentarily. So here's an example use case. So your process, the process is writing some file. You know it's writing a file somewhere. Maybe it's reading some files, alternatively. But you don't know where. For example, maybe it's got a log file. And you just want to find where the log file is so you can find out what's going on. Well, it's probably holding the file open if it's really writing to it a lot. If it's doing that, that means there's a file descriptor for the file. A file descriptor is just a small integer that identifies the kernel's data structure corresponding to an open file. And we can find out about file descriptors. So, this out of the way. So here's, I want to know where's the log file for my wireless manager, because wireless keeps messing up. So pgrep will just look through all the processes, find the one that has that command name. There's the PID, and there's this directory inside procpid. Procpidfd has an entry for every file descriptor in the process. And either one of them looks like a log file, var log, etc. This one actually is, you could have guessed it just looking at var log. But sometimes the authors are too cool for var log. It's somewhere weird in temp or something like that. So that's when this is useful. So that's procpidfd. We'll actually see a little more about it later. That's pretty useful. Here's another use case. So again, the process is working in some file. But maybe what you really want to know is how far has the process gotten so far? It's a long job. You just want to know, is it half done? Is it a tenth done? How long is it going to, how much longer is it going to be? Well, if in the course of doing its work, it's working through some file, then you can get a pretty good clue by seeing how far in the file it's gotten. So that we can also get from proc. So there's, in addition to FD, there's this directory tree parallel to that, FDinfo, procpid FDinfo. So this is a bit of an abstract example. We've got some slow job. It's consuming a big old file. The shell tells us the PID when we background it. So if we look in procpid FDinfo, and particularly say we look at file descriptor 0, that's standard input. You could also just ls and look around and figure out which one it is. It just tells us two things. And one is how far along it's gotten. That's in bytes. The other thing is flags, which I actually don't know how to interpret. It'd be cool to look it up and find out. But that's flags that describe the nature of the file descriptor. So there it is. It's 344k in, or decimal k. And you can even whip up a little progress bar. Here's a shell for loop. That's all it is. Finding the position each time. And hey, it's advancing about 10 megabytes every tenth of a second. So that's going like 100 megabytes a second. It's not actually that slow a job. It's just a big file. So that's FDinfo and the position. Another use case. Say, here interest may not be in the process so much as the file that it was working on. Some file's been deleted. We really wanted that file. But fortunately, there's a process that's holding it open. It turns out it can't be really deleted, truly fully deleted, as long as the process holds it open, even though it's deleted from the file system. That's the way that that Unix file systems work. And in fact, thanks to proc, we can get at that still existing sort of zombie file. And the way we do that is back with procpidfd. So we saw before just a set of the example. It's sort of a simple toy version. We make a file. We put a process in the background that holds the file open, trying to read it, reading it again and again. A moment later, we remove the file. And again, the shell tells us the PID of the backgrounded process. So if you look in procpidfd, as we saw before, it has the form of a symlink, a symbolic link. But here's something odd. It's the text of the link is the path followed by a space and then in parentheses the word deleted. That's not going to do as much good as an actual literal symlink. It's not like there's a file by the name blah 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 slash foo space paren deleted close paren. But what's really going on is that this is more magical than an ordinary symlink. And in fact, and that's because this is proc. It's full of magic. If we just go and open that file by name in procpidfd, it will go and open the actual underlying file. This wouldn't be possible by any path in the file system. It's gone. We've removed it. But in the proc file system, we can actually still get at it. And so now you can go and copy the contents away somewhere safe or whatever you want to do. So there we are. So that is more proc. Here's another rather different thing you can do with proc. So this is a situation that probably many of you have been in. You have some program. It's doing the wrong thing. It seems like maybe it's getting the wrong version of a library. Like this bug is happening, and you're sure you fixed the bug, and you installed the version of the library that fixes the bug, but somehow it's behaving as if it has the old version. So some of the things you might do are go and study all the stuff that configures where it expects to find the library. That could be useful, but you already thought you installed a new version, and that stuff can be pretty confusing. There can often be layers of different things that configure where to find and so on. So you really want to find the ground truth. What is it actually loading? That would really help you out. So we can do this with procpid. Because shared libraries, so the kind of library you typically have with a C program, C++, other languages, and then also extension modules for Python or C extensions for Ruby or similar things for other languages, all of those are shared libraries. And the way that shared libraries get treated is they get mapped into the program's address space. And we can ask the kernel, what maps does this process have? That's procpid maps. And so here's a simple example. It's just a trivial Python program that just imports a library JSON that happens to contain an extension module underscore JSON. And so we want to find out where did it get that extension module from. And there's procpid maps. This is all the maps in the program, except I've abbreviated it. It's much longer than that. But this is the beginning of it. And there's a lot of information here. All this information we use on the right context. For this purpose, we don't care about any of these first columns. We only care about the name of the file, which is the last column. It's actually so long that it runs off the slide, but you can use Perl or your favorite one-liner to take out just the one column. And then if we take that, we grep for the name we know it'll have, there's our answer. It's getting it from user libpython27 libdownload, which is, I believe, where the Debian package and the Ubuntu package put the standard libraries extension modules. So there we are. That tells us where does the library come from. And there's some other sides to this problem that other tools to talk about can help with. So if the thing responds, there we are. So just to run through again the various features we saw, there's procpid fd, tells you about all the files it has open. FDinfo tells you more detail about those open files. Procpid FD works even when the thing has been deleted, which is excellent. And Procpid Maps tells you what's been mapped in, including all the shared libraries. There's many, many more things. I encourage you sometime when you're bored, hopefully not right now, to look in some procpid directory. $$ just gives you your shell's PID. Just poke around. Or look at the documentation. Unfortunately, I should warn you, the documentation is incomplete. The developers keep adding things to proc, often very useful things, and then, but then they don't bother themselves to actually add it to the documentation. Somebody else later notices and catches up with the documentation. So there we are. And before I move on to the next tool, let's open it for questions. Yeah. Okay, not familiar with that one.
Okay. I'm not sure exactly when that was added. It was maybe about a few years old.
Okay.
But that gives you a formatted stack call.
Okay, that does sound useful.
Yeah.
Okay, that makes sense. Yeah, that's kind of what I figured. Then you have to know the values of those flags to interpret it. So you can look that up somewhere. Yeah. is also, it's worth noting, it's an octal, which it tries to hint to you by leading it with a zero. Yeah.
So how about if you, there's some process running on your system, you'd like to know more about it, you don't even know how it started, so you can't just best trace it. Is there some way you can get the equivalent of a best trace?
Well, we'll get to S-trace in a moment, and you can actually S-trace an already running process, which is very handy. Yeah, so some of our examples will be that. Other questions? On proc or generally, but generally might be later. Yeah? I believe BSD has something called proc, a proc file system. Sorry? LinProc? Okay, which is a port of the, okay. Yeah, that's all I know. Any other questions? Next up is S-trace. All right, go to S-trace. There'll be more questions later. So proc was the outside view at a given moment. It's what the kernel knows right now about this process. Strace is this dual. It will watch the process as it goes and see the changes that happen, the new interactions that happen. So what Strace does, it watches all the system calls. Every time the process communicates with the kernel, asks the kernel to do something, asks it some question, Strace will pick that up and it'll tell you all about it. It also tells you about signals, but that's less often useful. So there's a lot of system calls. Just to give you some of the most common and informative ones, if the process interacts with files, then it may stat to see if they're there. It may open them. Once opened, it may read and write from the resulting file descriptor. If it talks to the network, it may open a socket. It may then do connect on the socket, which I believe is to give it a file descriptor. Then it might read and write that file descriptor. There's also other ways it could do it. If it starts other processes, it will probably first clone, which is the system call that is used to implement the fork library call. Sometimes it'll vfork instead, which is differently optimized. Having done that to create a child process, it will probably go and execute a new program with execve, and then the parent might wait for the child to finish, or it might do other things. It might kill some process. Even to find out what time it is requires a system call, because that's part of the outside world, right? So you'll see processes doing clock get time to find out what time it is. So those are some of the things that you could pick up. There's many more. So a simple demo, just to give you a taste of what it looks like to use Strace. Here is the complete trace. This is the smallest font in the presentation. Probably the simplest program in your slash bin directory. Simplest program in your system, really. Which is true, which is the program that does nothing successfully. Just to run through a bit of what happens here. So the first thing is that the new process executes true, bin true. Then it gives up any heap it had. Then the dynamic linker does a bunch of work. All of this and maybe that is a dynamic linker. So it goes and it goes and checks to see if some file exists. It doesn't. And you can see here already the format that Strace gives you. It's the name of the system call. It's in parens to sort of look like a function call. It's the arguments. And it's pretty smart. It knows the types of all these arguments and the types even beyond the C sense. It knows, well, the first thing is a string, so it prints a string. It knows that the next thing, not only is it an int or whatever it is, but it's actually flags, and it knows what the names of the relevant flags are. So instead of giving you what the raw number is, that is this flags argument, it actually says, oh, I recognize that. That's FOK, is the relevant flag for the access system call to interpret that number. And so that's really what makes Strace real valuable. It knows all that information. And then when it returns, the return value is -1, which is an error. Strace tells you also, oh, it knows that's an error. Therefore, it goes and checks what error no was set, or what error was produced. which is enoant, and it gives you the expansion of what that means, no such file directory. So the dynamic linker looks for this. It's not there. It maps some anonymous memory, looks for something else. That's not there either. It opens a different file. It's confident that'll be there, I guess. And again, Strace parses out the flags, but the flags have different names here. And that returns successfully. It returns 3. That's the file descriptor. Open returns a file descriptor. And now the next thing goes and works on that file descriptor, fstat64. The first argument is 3. And this provides an example of a different mode of operation Strace ends up having, which is for some system calls, if there's a complex bit of information that needs to be returned, the output, and this is a common thing in C program generally, the output is actually to an argument, or to the referent of an argument past the system call. So this argument is a pointer. It's not really useful for Strace to tell you what the value of the pointer is. What you really want, and what Strace gives you, is what was the output that was returned into that pointer. And so if you manage to catch it before it's returned, it'll actually just say name, comma, space, and it sits there. When it does return, that's when it prints that argument. And again, Strace knows the type of this. It knows the names of the fields. It knows how to interpret this as a combination of some flag and an octal permission mask. So Strace has a lot of information, a lot of intelligence that it uses to really help you interpret what's going on here. And so the stat is successful, and that's part of the information. Then it goes and maps the whole contents of that file. The next to last argument of mmap is the file descriptor. That's the size. It matches the whole size of the file. So it's mapping the whole thing. And then it closes that because now the whole thing is in its address space. It doesn't need the file descriptor anymore. And I'll take a question. Sorry? Yeah. Yeah, it's saying there are more fields here, and it's choosing not to print them. Yeah, I mean, in this case, I think it probably just has a fixed list. It's going to tell you the mode and the size and forget the rest. For some things, one related thing, and I don't know if you can configure this, one related thing is these strings. Sometimes a string is long, like here. And so by default, it prints, I believe, 64 bytes of the string, maybe 32. There's a flag you can pass, dash S, some other value, and it'll print longer strings. There may be a way to tell it to print other fields here. I'm not sure. Other questions right now, or I'll move on. So having done that, goes and checks this file again. Don't know why. It opens libc. That's important. It reads the first half kilobyte of that, stats it again, maps part of it, tells another thing about how to set up the address space, maps some more parts of that file, or rather one, then anonymous thing, then closes the file. More address space set up, set thread area, I don't actually know what that means. And then finally, it's all done with the setting of the address space, and it does its job, which is to successfully exit. And so that is the complete trace of bin true. As it suggests, typically it'll be pretty long. There's some ways to filter it, which we'll get into, and also you can always just put it into a pager and check it out. Yeah?
How much of that is happening inside of true, and how much of that is the operating system doing stuff for true?
Uh-huh. So all of this is requests that the user space code in the process is making to the operating system. You may not see it in the source. So most of this is done by the C library. So it's part of the user space code in the process, but it's not part of the source code, or the application source code. It's stuff that the C runtime put into it. Right, it's part of the binary. If you go look at the machine code of the binary, you'll see it. Yeah. Other questions on the trace, or we'll go on to use cases of trace? So here's the use case. So say you have some process and it's stuck. This doesn't seem to be doing anything. You just want to know what is it trying to do right now. Why is it stuck? You can do that with Strace. So here's our first example, tracing an already running process. You just give it dash P. And then the PID. So say we have this process, we know it's stuck. Let's trace it, and it'll give you, output looks like this. It's in the middle of a system call. Typically, if it's stuck, it's in the middle of a system call. If it's not, you won't get this output. And so we have, well, it's in an flock system call. It's trying to lock the file that is file descriptor 3, and it's trying to get an exclusive lock. And there's no closed paren because it's still in the middle of that system call. So that's the answer Strace gives us. It's in the middle of trying to lock this thing. We can dig further. We can go back to the proc file system, find out what that file descriptor is. So Strace is telling us how it's interacting, and then proc gives us all the background of the other stuff that the kernel knows already about the process. And the answer is, well, it's this file. Well, okay, we can debug that further. We could either look back in procfs and look at all the FD directories, proc star FD and like grep for this file name. That would totally work. LSOF is a program that I think basically does the same work, but it prints it nicer. And so you can do that in grep for the name. And we say, well, here's that process we're already looking at. There's another process. And that must be the one that's holding the lock. You can't hold flocks without having a file descriptor. So it must be the one that's holding it. And so now you can go and debug further, like, why is this other one hanging out so long? Do the two processes really need to hold the same lock, et cetera? So Strace gave you the key initial information. This is what it's doing right now. And then procfs told you more. Another use case. You have a process. This is similar to the library kill example. The process is it needs a config file. It's clearly finding some config file, but it's not finding the config file you expected. Or it doesn't seem to be. Maybe it is. You want to find out. Where is it finding its config file? So Strace is great for this. A simple example, just running git. So we trace git. There's a few things going on here. One, as we saw, it's really long even for a simple thing. For a real program like this, it's going to be a giant trace. So you've got to filter it. You could just put it into a pager. But for a slide, that doesn't work. So on a slide, you want to use grep or something. There's a couple different filters going on here that are useful. One is I'm grepping it. And in order to grep it, I redirect standard error to standard output because Strace puts the stuff on standard error. You'll discover that quickly if you try to play with it. The other filtering going on is a Strace thing, which is before the actual command to run, or before the dash p or whatever, you can tell it a filter. You can tell it only look at these types of syscalls. And you can tell it either a name of a syscall, you can tell it a bunch of names with commas between them. You can also tell it whole classes of syscalls. So file is a great one because it contains all the syscalls that refer to files by their file names, by path names. So it includes everything that could possibly be looking for a config file in particular, because that's got to be communicating in terms of file names. And these classes are good also because if you don't use the classes, you'll forget some of them. You'll forget access, maybe, or you'll forget stat 64, or you'll forget something else. And so if you go through this, well, we basically get our answer. It's looking there for system thing. It's looking in my .config directory, which I don't use. It's looking at my actual thing in the home group. Then it opens it. It's looking in this repository. Then it opens it. There's our answer. Then it does it all again for some reason, which seems like a bad behavior. But there we are. In some other case, it might be more complicated. But it tells us the whole sequence what's going on. Another use case. It's invoking some other program wrong. So we can solve that too. After all, invoking a program is another thing that needs to talk to the system. The one really new thing here that I haven't mentioned before is Strace initially is just looking at one process. But if you want to know how it's invoking some other process, that actually happens in the child. Right? First it makes the child process. Then the child goes and executes something else. So you really want to follow into the child. Fortunately, there's a flag for this, dash F for follow. And so Strace dash F, my example here is just make in my slides directory. Make, you know, this is a simple make, so it's not an example you really need it because it tells you after all what's going on, but more complicated makefile, this might be really useful. Or in some nasty wrapper script, this can be exactly what saves the day. And so you just filter to find only the process-related things and follow. And so there we start, we have make, it prints what it's doing, so we didn't really need it here. And then forks with vfork, and then executes. And there we are. There's the exact command that's being executed. No variables to wonder what they are, nothing. This is the actual command that's being executed as it happens. Here, actually, it tries something, because it's searching through path. That doesn't exist. But ultimately, one succeeds. That's the one that actually got run. So there's the answer for that use case. And so just to digest all the things we saw, you can strace and then give a command. It's a classic way to use it. It'll go and execute the command for itself, and you strace from the beginning, which can be very handy. You can strace an already running process, which is often what you need. You can give it a filter expression, either a class of syscalls or individual syscalls. You can also invert things. You can have file colon exclamation point access, and you won't see the access calls. You can follow to child processes. There's many, many other things you can do. You can see the timing in several different ways. You can print strings longer, as I mentioned. There are other filters you can do. I encourage you to read the man page. It'll tell you all those things. Other questions on strace before I move on to other tools? Yes?
Does strace maintain
the Linux kernel? I don't think so. No, I think it's quite separate. The next tool we'll talk about actually is maintaining the kernel. But I don't know. That's a good question. Sorry? Right, it works through ptrace. So ptrace is the underlying kernel mechanism that uses to get access to what's going on and be notified when a system call happens. It does need a certain amount of per architecture intelligence to know the numbers of system calls and to be able to interpret the arguments to some degree. Yeah, I expect so. We'll find out. Other questions on strace? Yeah. With dtrace? So have you used dtrace?
No.
Okay. So I think they're fairly different. I've managed to use dtrace just a little bit. Unfortunately, it's not generally available on Linux. Dtrace is a really impressive achievement. It goes a lot deeper than strace can. It involves a lot of help from the kernel and a lot of intelligence basically provided by the kernel with all kinds of different hooks inside the kernel, and it has its own language in which you actually write things that happen every time some event fires, and the language is carefully constrained so that running this like many, many times in the kernel can't overwhelm memory or take too much time and so on. So dtrace is a very flexible tool. You could use it, I'm sure you can use it to do the same thing that strace does. I don't know if you'd have the same intelligence for interpreting the arguments and so on. Maybe you would. You can also use it for other things. I don't know much about it, though. Yeah?
If you're on a system like OS 10 and you'd like to have strace, the equivalent of dtrace is called dtrust.
All right. Okay.
Trust, right? Yeah.
So that's like strace, but implemented with a dtrace.
Yep.
Cool.
There's also
DTRDSS.
Yeah. Other questions? Any more questions? Move on to the next tool. All right. So those are the two great outside tools. T-Shark is great too, but I didn't describe it in detail. Now we'll go inside. So the thing about inside is the outside view, for the reasons I talked about, is great when it works. It's this universal interface, single skill set. And the process has to do a lot of things through the outside. But sometimes you do need to look inside. Sometimes what's going wrong really is just inside the program's own twisted logic and isn't directly reflected in how it talks to the outside. So there's a couple tools I'll talk about for this. One is perf. So perf is a fabulous profiler. It's a tool for seeing where your program is spending time, if it's slow. And what really gives it its edge is it's in cahoots with the kernel and also your CPU, at least on x86. I'm not sure whether CPUs it might be able to be in cahoots with. What that allows, so it's this is developed in tandem with the kernel. It's actually part of the kernel tree, is the perf source. That's part of how it gets in cahoots so well. And the way that it profiles, rather than, you know, many of us remember using gprof, which was great in its day. And that worked, and other profiles would work by actually setting up an alarm to fire a signal every so often, and then setting a signal handler, sig alarm was the signal, a signal handler that every time it fires goes and sees what's on the stack and records that. Just sees, or not even the stack, but actually just records where the instruction pointer is, what code is running right now. That can be useful. And then gprof could also do call graph profiles, but with a lot of instrumentation, but they could be misleading. What perf does, it avoids the whole signal thing. Signals are a mess. You don't really want to use signals if you avoid it. And it gets a great deal more precision by, on appropriate architectures, including x86, it sets special registers in the CPU. Special registers that count down on every clock cycle. And so it sets this register to some value, the number of clock cycles it wants, and then when it counts down to zero, an interrupt fires that the kernel handles, and it records actually not only the instruction pointer, but the whole stack trace at that moment, if you ask for a call graph profile. If not call graph, then just the instruction pointer. And so it gets you a really high fidelity map of where the time is going. The actual values of instruction pointers at this this timing managed by the CPU. And the kernel also, when the process is descheduled, it saves the registers. When it's scheduled again, it restores the registers back. So you really get very accurate time counting on this process specifically. And it also gives you, I don't think so, it also gives you a call graph profile that's based on the actual contents of the stack. So that, for example, you have some generic helper function, and one thing is calling it really slow instances. Another is calling it in very fast, harmless instances. It'll actually tell you that all that time should be attributed to the one caller, not the other. Whereas older profilers like gprof could only tell you how many calls were happening, not which ones were slow. So this is a fabulous tool. We're running nearly out of time, so I may skip some of what the slides say here. The way you use it is quite simple. You just say perf record in the command. You can also use it on already running process. This is the most common useful way. Here's an example, some like absurdly slow thing in Ruby startup, which I debugged and partly fixed last year. It just records it out to a file called perf.data. You can also pass a flag to tell it some other file name. Having recorded, you get to, you also get to run perf report. That'll go and read that same file again. You can tell it some other file name. And it'll give you this profile report. And it actually gives you a nice little in-terminal browser, or a GUI browser, but I think the terminal is the best maintained, where you can go and look at the, you hit enter on one of these, you can see the actual machine code, you can hit various things to filter the profile and so on. That's real handy. This is just a version for the slide. It's not as awesome as the browser. You can also do call graph profiling. You just say dash G when you record. Now it has the whole call stacks. And now in your report, it'll tell you the actual expanded call graph profile. And again, it's a browser. You can expand, contract things here. The browser becomes really valuable. This is just a sort of snapshot for the slide based on expanding some and not expanding others. That's really, really handy. That is perf. Other questions on perf? We have 1 minute nominally. We can go a few minutes over if people desire. Yeah. Pretty small. It's like a few percent, 3%, 5% maybe. So it's pretty impressive. Yeah. I'm sorry? Yes. Yeah, so these are at the C level, these are C functions. It won't help you so much if you are trying to profile at, like, in this case, a Ruby level or a Python level or whatever, for that you need something else. The tool that I've heard people use to good effect is Google Perf Tools, that is Perf Tools from Google, which people have also, you can adapt them, and somebody's adapted, at least for Ruby, adapted them to give decent Ruby profiles as well. Other questions on Perf?
Does the code have to be
WebAssembly? Yeah, that would certainly help, yeah. I mean, it could tell you something without that, but it's better with debug symbols. Other questions? You should, just in general, you really should always be running with debug symbols. That's people that run, like, sometimes I hear people talking about, yeah, we didn't have debug symbols, and somebody from Google is present, and they're horrified that you would ever run something without debug symbols. Basically, if you're running stuff in production, you should be running with debug symbols, because something will go wrong, and then you'll be happy you did. Other questions? We are out of time formally, but I'm happy to take questions in another couple minutes, because there's a long break. Uh-huh. T-A-U? Okay. All right. Okay. Cool. Didn't know about it. I'll check it out. All right. People seem eager to go, so that's the end of the talk.